I wasn't Muslim, so I didn't say anything. Then they came for the Arabs, and I wasn't an Arab, I didn't say anything. Then they came for the gays, lesbians, and transgenders, so I wasn't part of them, so I didn't say anything. And then they came for me, and there was no one left. So that was Martin Niemöller. From 1937 to 1945, he was in the Sachsenhausen and Dachau prison concentration camps. He probably wasn't killed because he was a war hero from World War I. But Hans and Sophie Scholl were not so lucky. These were two, a brother and sister, Hans and Sophie. There's a feature film called Sophie Scholl, which you might see. It streams, I think it's on Netflix, I'm not sure. Scholl is S-C-H-O-L-L. They were students in their 20s at the University of Munich, and they had reached the breaking point with the regime. And this is at the height of Nazi power in the early 1940s. And they got a stenography machine and some kind of printing press, and they started, you know, printing leaflets and writing graffitis on the walls. The most famous one is, "Every word that comes out of Hitler's mouth is a lie." You can just think of someone today and just change the name of the politician and you might have some resonance. And they were spreading these pamphlets around campus, enormous risk, and ultimately they were arrested and beheaded. They were sent to the guillotine, but they had said, "Genug, this is enough, we can't take it anymore." And so they stood up as Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who said, another German theologian of the period, who said, "Not to speak against evil is to be part of evil." And it was Orwell in 1984 who said of the proles, their silence is consent. Their silence is consent. So this is not a time for any of us to be good Germans, to look the other way. Oh, I didn't know what was happening. Gee, I thought that family went on vacation. I wonder why they didn't come back. You know, what is that? What does that mean? Why are the stormtroopers in the streets? Why did Gestapo's break down doors? I didn't know. I minded my own business. We cannot be like that. And I know many of you here in this community are not. You are engaged in one way or another with acts of resistance. But it's in community, it's in collectivity where we gather strength, where we gather a force that cannot be resisted. And that's why it's important to come together in meetings like this, not necessarily because I'm here, but you see your neighbors, you see friends, you make new friends. I hope you make some connections here, and perhaps in the Q&A session you can tell me about what's going on here, what demonstration is happening, what meeting is happening, what 350.org is doing here. Is there a Black Lives Matter here? Is there a Rise Up? Are there different groups here in Santa Fe and in this general area? So that's really important. One of the things I learned about activism and public speaking is also from my friend and mentor Howard Zinn, always inject a little bit of humor. So I know this is a little bit out of sequence, but I'll attribute that to mine to being a double Gemini.
Hallelujah.
I kind of skip around. Those of you who are Gemini understand the joke. If you don't, forget about it. But Howard Zinn always said, you know, inject a little bit of humor. So I invented this character a couple of years ago. Some of you may have heard about him. He was a very distinguished and erudite journalist. His name is Dick Veneer. I see you know him well. Dun, 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 dun. We interrupt this program from the CCA in Santa Fe, New Mexico, to bring you this breaking news story from TIBC, the Truth in Broadcasting Corporation, from our world corporate headquarters in our secure, state-of-the-artless underground studios in Roswell, New Mexico. I'm Dick Veneer, your glib and banal anchor of Facade News. Facade News, the 24/7 newscast dedicated to keeping you in the dark. We go straight to the surface of a story and we stay there. We make things up as we go along. The highest standards of journalism, unencumbered by elite concepts like the truth. Our reporters are dedicated to giving you fake news all the time, with a thorough disregard for facts. Our credos, unfair and unbalanced. We deceive, you believe. Ladies and gentlemen, an amazing story coming across our news desk at this very moment. Our exalted leader has determined that 2 and 2 is 5. He told Facade News in an exclusive interview that after much soul searching and deep consultations with his daughter and son-in-law, that he now concludes that long-held views of 2 plus 2 is 4 are wrong. He described the process while playing golf and said it was amazing and unbelievable. And he said the people love the tremendous math work we are doing. The great leader modestly added, I give myself a 10. I'm a very stable genius. Stay tuned for updates on this and other breaking stories right here on Facade News. I'm Dick Veneer, your still glib and banal anchor, and reminding you, believe our news or else. And now back to your regularly scheduled broadcast in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Well, there is a huge problem with, thank you for that. Dick appreciates the applause. I'm sure his ratings will skyrocket. But I have to tell you, I've been using Dick Veneer and Facade News for 5, 6, 7 years now. But in the last year or so, as things have gotten so morbid here in the country, and with all the problems emanating from the Oval Office and elsewhere, people don't laugh as much. You know, in some ways, oh, he said 2 and 2 is 5? That's plausible. Yeah, why not? He says other outrageous things. In fact, last night there was a report marking the completion of 2 years of the great prevaricator in office. And the Washington Post announced that they had documented, I think, 8,100 lies, if I'm not mistaken. But you know, we're off base, forgive me for saying this, if we concentrate solely on the egregious, outrageous excrement, you know, emanating from the mouth of the great prevaricator. He is a symptom of something much deeper. Mm-hmm. And if we just deal with surface problems, then when we're, you know, inviting ourselves for future incarnations of such a political leader. I was in New Orleans about a month ago and went to the Huey Long Museum. You all know the Kingfish? You know how Robert Penn Warren's great novel, All the King's Men? The great political novel actually written in 1946. It's modeled after the life of Huey Long. He was a senator from Louisiana and assassinated in 1935. He said when fascism comes to the United States of America, it will come with a Bible and an American flag. You could see those tropes manifesting themselves, you know, particularly emanating from the vice president's office. You know, again, any of you who get very excited about maybe impeaching the great prevaricator, be warned, there's somebody, you know, behind the curtain who might be even more dangerous, hard to believe. But Pence, I will use his name, when he was the governor of Indiana, tried to close the Planned Parenthood offices in that state, extreme right-wing kind of Taliban religious ideas that he has. He doesn't believe in gay marriage. His wife is now working at a charter school where you cannot attend if you're gay or you're transgender or, you know, anything like that. He's against gay marriage and on and on. You have to wonder, you know, as he sits there or stands there next to his, you know, great leader, sycophancy has taken on a new meaning with Pence, where he just stands, says nothing, barely moves, and occasionally nods his head up and down in agreement with whatever prevarication, you know, comes from the great leader's mouth. There was a recent study that Mother Jones published that links hours of news consumption to overall levels of fear and anxiety. It's really interesting, you know? The more you consume of news, there's a correlation to more fear and more anxiety. So I think we need to be careful about what we consume and the amount of it, because the internet is a trap, just like these phones are a trap. You go into it and you'll never come out. Oh, look at this article, she just forwarded this to me, let me pass this along. Oh, isn't this interesting? I didn't know this, my friend will be interested, let me send it on. And pretty soon, all we become are extensions of our thumb. And again, I think it's good to have the information, but unless we act on that information, it's in turn, and it's paralyzing us. It has a demobilizing effect.